table, Jesus,
thank you.
Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you.
Definitely had options.
It's good. Good songs. Let's continue our worship by turning over to Romans chapter 9. We're going from Romans chapter 9 into Romans chapter 10 this morning. And we want to just give a shout out to all of our people that are watching in cyberspace, watching on the internet this morning. Pastor Keith and Patty, we say hi to you guys, and we're just praying for you, Patty, and hoping that you're better soon. So Romans chapter 9, I'm going to begin in verse 30, and then we're going to read over into chapter 10 to the end of verse 4. In Romans chapter 9, what shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness attained righteousness, even the righteousness which is by faith. But Israel, that is the Jews, pursuing a law of righteousness, did not arrive at that law. Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as though it were by works. They stumbled over the stumbling stone, just as it is written, "Behold, I lay in Zion a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed." Brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer to God for them, that is for Israel, for the Jews, is for their salvation. For I testify about them that they have a zeal for God, but not in accordance with knowledge. For not knowing about God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own, they did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. Let's look to the Lord one more time before we enter into this. Father, we thank you for the gift of righteousness, which you put to the account fully of those who trust in your Son. That perfect, spotless righteousness, to be able to have bold standing with you, complete acceptance because of the righteousness of our Savior, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, that it's through faith, simply through faith, the open hand of faith, the believing eye of faith, that you give us everything that's in your Son, Jesus. Father, thank you for that. We pray that you will guide us as we work our way through this passage today for your glory. We want to remember to pray for Patty. We lift up Patty to you this morning, Lord God, that you will just strengthen her body. Lord, cause that blood pressure to come down. And we just pray for just your strength upon both she and Pastor Keith. Lord God, thank you for them. Thank you for the gift from you that they are to us. Lord God, just show your kindness and your goodness in their lives, we pray. Thank you now, in Jesus' name, Father, for all these things. Amen. Amen. Some of you have heard me describe how that one of my earliest childhood memories comes from about when I was 4 or 5 years old over in the state of Nevada. It was at the end of a hot summer day. It was about dusk. Dad had decided to take us as a family out for a ride in the blue Dodge Dart station wagon. We went over to across the Carson River, over to the east, across on the other side of the river, up into the Pinyon Hills, there outside of Carson City. We were driving along, and all of a sudden, Dad stopped the car. And he said that he saw something. Something caught his eye up on the hillside above. So he got out of the car. We watched him climb up the hill, up amidst the scattered sagebrush and the rock and the pinyon pine trees. And he came back down. We could see him. When he came down the hill, he was carrying something in his arms, something kind of white and fuzzy. And as he got closer to the car, we realized what he was carrying was a little lamb, a little white lamb in his arms, of all things. But we also noticed that the little lamb, something was wrong with it. Something was wrong with its hindquarters. Its hindquarters were streaked with blood, and there were some open lacerations. Well, Dad speculated that the little lamb was from one of the ranches, which was down closer to the Carson River, and that somewhere between the river, between the ranch and the hillside where it was found, the little lamb had gotten lost, and it had narrowly escaped perhaps a coyote or a roaming dog, which laid into it. Dad didn't think that it was going to last the night if he had left it up there. So we brought that little lamb home to our house in Carson City, and my little sister Tamara and I, for the next 2 weeks, got to hold and nurse that little lamb and try to work toward nursing it back to health. But the day came, as you can imagine, when our hearts were broken, when Dad brought that little lamb back to one of those ranches by the Carson River. And for the rest of my life, I never saw that little lamb again. But I came to love it. I came to love it, that little lost but now found lamb. I tell you this story because looking in the scriptures, one of the most endearing facts about Jesus, our Savior, is that he is the good shepherd who loves, who searches for, and who saves lost sheep. Not the four-legged kind, but the two-legged variety. It's people, right? Last week, Pastor Keith preached from that passage out of John chapter 10 where we heard the Lord Jesus say, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd lays down his life for who? For the sheep. In Luke's gospel, we read this. Luke records, "Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near Jesus to listen to him. Both the Pharisees and the scribes began to grumble, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.' So Jesus told them this parable, saying, 'What man among you, if he has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? When he's found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." I tell you, in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." It's a beautiful parable, isn't it? It really is. Not only do we see in that parable the passion of our Savior to seek and to search for lost sheep, but we also see his joy, the joy of our Lord in the salvation of one of his lost sheep. And this is something that we need to understand as we come to this passage this morning, that evangelism, proclamation of the gospel, sharing the good news of Christ to our friends and those around us, is not something that our Lord is cool and indifferent toward. Rather, it's his joy. It's his joy. Coming to Romans, we could even say that in chapter 9, which we've seen, we could even say that the Lord laying a hold of lost people is in fact his glory. It's his glory. You can see over in verse 23, it's his glory that he shows mercy and grace upon undeserving vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory. Their glory, as far as participating with him in glory, and his glory, right? As we cross today from Romans chapter 9 into chapter 10, we've seen that Romans chapter 9, it has been all about divine sovereignty, right? It's been all about sovereign grace. That the Lord has his people. He has his chosen people. And now we're going to see in chapter 10, whereas Romans 9 was all about divine sovereignty, Romans 10 is all about human responsibility. It's all about human responsibility. That is a person's responsibility to respond and believe in the gospel. I just want to remind you, Romans chapters 9 through 11 is all about Paul answering the question as far as how God's purposes have not failed in view of the reality that the majority of Jews have not believed in the gospel of Christ. They've failed from faith. And so Romans chapter 9 through 11 is Paul answering the question why God's purposes haven't failed. And what have we seen? Yes, it is true. The majority of the Jews have missed salvation. To this day, they miss salvation. But why hasn't God failed? Well, we saw, first of all, in chapter 9, that God has not failed because he always has his elect chosen people that he has been saving throughout history without fail. And so in no way is God a failure as far as saving those whom he ultimately desires to save. We've seen that in chapter 9. Now, next, in chapter 10, we're going to see that if the Jews do fail from salvation, it's not God's fault, but it's their fault for not believing. Okay? This is what we're going to see in chapter 10. They're the ones to blame for the failure to believe in Christ. And you can clearly see, one of the things we're going to see in this chapter is that Romans chapter 10 is all about the priority to believe, to trust Christ, to have faith in Christ. You look in this chapter and words having to do with believe, believes, believed are found some seven times. Words having to do with faith or faith is found three times. We see that confess or confesses is found two times. We find that the expression call on him or call on the name of the Lord is found three times. And so when you put these things all together, we see that Romans chapter 10 is all about the priority of believing, trusting Christ. You see? So Romans chapter 9, all about God's sovereignty and salvation. Romans chapter 10, all about man's responsibility to respond to the gospel. It really is a beautiful thing when you think about it. Having emphasized God's sovereignty, Paul follows it right up with man's responsibility. Now, we might struggle. We maybe think to ourselves, how can these two things exist? How can God both be sovereign in salvation, and how can people be responsible to believe in the gospel? We have a hard time wrapping our minds around those seemingly contradictory things. But Paul saw no apparent contradiction. Neither did Charles Spurgeon. Charles Spurgeon said that these two realities are like two railroad tracks that run parallel with each other throughout Scripture, and where they converge, where they come together, is somewhere before the throne of God. Even though we don't understand it, God has no problem understanding it, right? Now let me just say this. Admittedly, there are those who say that believing in such sovereign grace, if you believe in election, if you believe that God chooses people to salvation, well, if you believe that, that kills the motivation for evangelism. You've heard that, I've heard that. It just kills evangelism. That was Wesley's argument, right? But really, the truth is quite the opposite. Belief in sovereign grace, when you believe these things in balance, it really is a motivation. It's an encouragement to evangelism. How so? Well, think about it. Think about this. Believing in such things gives hope and courage. When Paul was at Corinth, Luke tells us this in Acts chapter 18, verses 9 and 10. He says, and the Lord said to Paul in the night by a vision, don't be afraid any longer, but go on speaking, and don't be silent, for I am with you, and no man will attack you in order to harm you, for I have many people in this city. Do you hear that? Paul didn't know who they were. But the Lord told him to continue to be faithful, courageous, because the Lord had many people. Again, the elect that were there. Belief in sovereign grace also gives endurance in the midst of adversity. Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 10. Listen to this. This is such a great statement. For this reason, I endure all things. What reason, Paul? For the sake of those who are chosen, so that they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus, and with it eternal glory. He endured all things for the sake of the elect. You see? So I say these things because, you know, right away, I hope you see and I hope you sense that God's sovereignty and salvation in no way kills the spirit of evangelism, but it gives hope and courage to us. Very practically, think about this. How many of us maybe have a child that is so wayward, so hard-hearted, so resistant to God that we look at such a child and no way can they become a believer. But can God be kept from anyone's heart once he is determined to lay hold of anyone? No. No way. We see right here in Romans chapter 10 that such things do not kill the spirit of evangelism as we look at Paul's expression of prayer, his zeal, his passion for the lost right here in verses 1 through 4. There are three main things that I just want to try to draw our focus to in these verses. We see in verse 1, we see his passionate prayer for the lost. You see that right there in verse 1. Secondly, we see in verses 2 and 3 the terrible plight of the lost. The plight of the lost. And then finally, in verse 4, we see the path of salvation to the lost. Okay, so these three things. Now, right away, we see in this passage Paul's emphasis of praying for his fellow Jews, the lost Jews. Again, verse 1, look at it. Brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer to God for them is for their salvation. Now, before we break this apart, before we look at that verse more closely, let's respond once again to the person that says, again, the person that says, well, if you believe in sovereign grace, why pray? Right? If God has determined destinies, if he is determined in his own mind who is going to be saved and who's not, why pray? It's a foregone conclusion. Right? How many of us have heard that? Maybe you struggle with it. Maybe you struggle with it. You know, why pray? It just seems to make no sense if God has his elect. Well, again, several things we would probably say in answer to this. First of all, God's decision of determining destinies, God choosing who he will to salvation, is his secret counsel. It's his secret. I don't know who the elect are. You don't know who the elect are. Paul didn't know who all the elect were there at Corinth. But the Lord told him, I have many people in this city. Right? So that is God's prerogative to know who is elect, who isn't. A second thing is this, that God uses means to accomplish his ends. We see right here within this chapter, Paul tells us, look at verses 14 and 15 regarding, you know, the elect are out there, but the gospel has to be preached, right? Look at verse 14. How then will they call on him whom they've not believed? How will they believe in him whom they've not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? They've got to hear the gospel to be saved, right? Similarly, God uses prayer as a means to save people. I think about the true story of a woman named Monica who lived during the 4th century AD. Monica was a devoted Christian mom, and she was married to a non-believing man. And she had a beloved son by the name of Augustine. You maybe have heard the story before. She witnessed to Augustine. She tried to raise him up, nurture him in the faith. But when Augustine left the house, he moved away. He pursued a life of sin. He lived in sexual sin for years. And it just broke Monica's heart. But she continued to pray for her son, Augustine, all through those years, just yearning for him through fasting and praying and weeping. This led one local unnamed bishop to console her by saying, "The child of those tears shall never perish." And you know that Augustine could not outrun his mom's prayers, and he couldn't outrun the long arm of the Lord. And it's just an amazing story of his incredible conversion. I just encourage you guys to read more about the life of Augustine. A third thing that I would say this, you know, pretty much anyone who prays for the salvation of someone else prays as someone who believes in sovereign grace. Lord, change their heart, right? Lord, open her eyes to see the wonder of Christ. Lord, give them the faith in order to believe. In other words, pretty much everyone who prays for the salvation of someone else prays as a Calvinist. You've heard me say that before. Maybe that's offensive to some here, but I don't know. Think about it. Now, several things stand out to us about Paul's prayer here. One of the things which we really don't see in the English here is just the emphatic nature of Paul's prayer, which we'd probably more literally read this way, where Paul says, "Brethren, indeed, my heart's desire and prayer to God for them is for their salvation." It was indeed his desire and his prayer. The word for desire there in that verse literally has the idea of what pleases or what gives a person pleasure. And so what Paul is saying is that, indeed, brother, what would really give me pleasure, what would really delight my heart would be their salvation. Yeah, that's his emphasis. In other words, Paul prayed with fervent passion. He prayed with fervent passion. And it begs a question for you and I. Are our prayers hot and directed toward the salvation of someone else, or are our prayers cold and apathetic? C.S. Lewis once said that to simply say prayers is not to pray. Otherwise, a team of properly trained parrots would serve as well as men. Do we pray with passion? Secondly, we see not only was Paul's prayer passionate, the word that is translated prayer right there in verse 1 is not the usual word for prayer. It's interesting. It's a word which actually has the idea of to lack or to need. And so it again has the idea of intensity in it. It's not a word that is used quite often within the scriptures. In the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, the word is used in Psalm chapter 5, verse 3, where David cries out to the Lord, "Heed the sound of my cry for help." Same word, "my King and my God." The same word is used of Zacharias' prayer. If you remember in Luke chapter 1, where Zacharias pled with the Lord to give he and Elizabeth a child. Remember that? It was also the very word that was used of Jesus' own pleas in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7, where it says this, "In the days of his flesh," in the days of Jesus' flesh, "he offered up both pleas and supplications with loud crying and tears to the one who was able to save him from death." So, do you get the idea? This was a passionate plea on the part of the Apostle Paul for his fellow Jews. But third, notice that his prayer, his plea, was purposeful. What was the purpose of his prayer? What did he ask? Well, his prayer, his plea had a specific request, that is their salvation. He was praying for the salvation of his fellow Jews. Now, let me just ask you, do you ever step back from your own personal prayers and just analyze what it is that you're specifically asking God to do? If you were to record your prayers over a given week or a given month, what have been some of the things that you have specifically been asking God to do? I think many of our prayers, we pray, "Give me strength," right? That's good. Or we pray, "Protect us on this trip," It's good. Those are good things. Or Lord, help me to feel better. Again, good. But when we say that, you know, as far as prayers are concerned, there are those good things to pray for, there are those better things to pray for, and then there are those best things to pray for. Let me just say this. If, as we've seen in chapter 9, if God's glory is most conspicuously seen or put on display in His showing mercy and grace to people that don't deserve it, wouldn't that be one of the best things to pray for? That is, for the salvation of someone else. I think it is. I think it is. Paul's prayer was purposeful. And we see the reason as we shift, you know, we think now about, we've thought about Paul's passionate prayer. Now think with me about the plight of the lost. In verses 2 and 3, we really see why Paul was so concerned to pray for their salvation. And that was because of their pitiful plight, their absolute sad condition, their utter lostness. And what Paul says in verses 2 and 3 regarding the Jews, I think could actually be said of pretty much every person who is lost. The same things in many ways could be said of them as well. So we ought not to only think about the Jews here, but to think about all lost people. Now notice four things. I want to just draw four things to your attention out of verses 2 and 3. First of all, in verse 2, Paul he starts off by praying the Jews a kind of backhanded kind of compliment. You see it right there in verse 2. He says in verse 2, "For I testify about them that they have a zeal for God." It's kind of a backhanded compliment. They have a zeal for God. What is zeal? Well, zeal is impassioned devotion, right? Zeal is steadfast commitment, you know, being serious about what it means to be a follower of God. Some of you who are San Francisco Giants are, you know what it is to be zealous, or Bronco fans. You're zealous, right, regarding the Broncos. Paul pays them this compliment that they are zealous toward God, but their zeal is misguided. Their zeal is wrong. Paul said of himself, remember this in Philippians chapter 3, verse 6, "As to zeal, I was a persecutor of the church." Was Paul zealous? Yes, he was. But he was zealously wrong. He was zealously wrong. I think these days in our American culture, zeal is really held up as a high value. And it doesn't matter what you believe in our day, unless it's biblical Christianity, right? It doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're zealous about it. You can be zealous in believing that crystals are the guiding force of the universe. You can be zealous in believing that all earth on life came from space dust. As long as you're zealous in your belief of such things, right? What our culture has a hard time acknowledging, as with the zealous protesters that we've seen over the course of these last number of months, is that someone can be zealously wrong. To be zealously wrong. I've been zealously wrong at different times in my life. Terry can tell you that two times I've gotten lost looking for Christmas trees. In the state of Colorado once, up at Lassen Park, thinking I was going very much in the right direction, knew where I was going, got lost. My family can tell you about the time that I was driving our minivan, towing a tent trailer behind us in San Francisco. I don't know if you remember this, Charity, but I thought I was going in the right direction, but all of a sudden I found myself going the wrong direction on the Golden Gate Bridge with six lines of traffic coming at me. Praise God for His grace that I was able to do a U-ey and get pointed in the right direction. I know what it's like to be zealously wrong. You see, apart from God's intervention, this is Paul's point, I think, in this passage, apart from God's intervention, it's literally impossible for his fellow Jews or for anyone else who is going in the wrong direction to get pointed in the right direction. Yeah, they were zealous, but they were zealously wrong. Secondly, Paul indicates of the lost that they're ignorant of the truth. Notice what he says here, "For I testify about them that they have a zeal for God, but not in accordance with knowledge." What he's saying, in other words, is that they're ignorant of the truth. Elsewhere in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4, Paul said this, "Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, in whose case the god of this world," that Satan, "has blinded the minds of the unbelieving so that they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ." Lost people are ignorant of the truth. They're blind to the truth. He said pretty much the same thing in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Paul said, "But a natural man doesn't accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually discerned." Are those not some of the most dire descriptions of a natural person's inability to perceive and understand the truth? They're blind. They don't accept God's truth. Indeed, they can't even understand God's truth apart from the Spirit of God working within them. In a word, they're ignorant of the truth. Now again, in these days of political correctness, the worst thing that you can do is insinuate that someone is ignorant. Right? You just don't do that these days. Your truth is your truth and my truth is my truth, and don't you ever tell me that my truth is not truth. That's the day in which we live. Even if someone is completely out there in la-la land. But what did Jesus and Paul say to others? Well, you remember when the time when the Jews came testing Jesus, asking him about this theoretical woman who has had seven husbands, all of them brothers, and they've all died, and whose wife is she going to be in the hereafter? Do you remember what Jesus said to them? Jesus said, "You're mistaken, not understanding the scriptures nor the power of God." In other words, you're ignorant. I think of what Paul told the Athenians. Remember in Acts chapter 17, Paul saw this altar with the inscription to an unknown god, and he said to them, "What you worship in ignorance, that's what I'm going to proclaim to you." Now granted, in speaking with people within our culture about the gospel, we need to be humble and sensitive, you know, to not try to commit certain social faux pas. I think all of us should try to be wise in that regard. But it doesn't change the fact that apart from God working in people's hearts, apart from the Holy Spirit illumining their minds, giving them the light of the gospel, people are in ignorance, right? They are. That's why you and I must pray hard that the Lord opens the understanding, opens the eyes of those who are lost. And that's what Paul is praying. Thirdly, like the lost Jews, pretty much any person who is lost is typically misguided about righteousness, what it means to be accepted by God. Everyone needs righteousness to be accepted by God. The question is, where is that righteousness going to come from, right? And this is what Paul says in verse 3. Look again. "For not knowing about God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own, they did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God." As we've said before, you know this, the typical Jewish approach to try to gain God's approval to be righteous in God's eyes was how? It wasn't through faith. It was through trying to keep the works of the law. Again, look back at chapter 9. We saw that. Verse 31 and 32, "But Israel, pursuing a law of righteousness, did not arrive at that law." Why? Because they didn't pursue it by faith, but as though it were by works. That was their great stumbling block. They tried to gain God's righteousness, to gain God's approval by the works of the law, you see. Okay? I've used this illustration before. You know, God gave his law to function more or less like railroad tracks, to guide our lives over the course of this life, in what is right, what is wrong. But what the Jews did, or they tried to do with those railroad tracks, they tried to invert it and turn it into a ladder by which they could climb to heaven. And it was completely unfounded. And this is the typical way that lost people think that they're going to be saved, right? You've heard me say this. Becky, you know this question. If you were to die tonight and you were to appear before God and God was to ask you, "Why should I let you into my heaven?" What's the typical response of people? Well, they hymn and they haw and they say, "Well, God, I've I've not been the perfect person. Who is?
Right.
But at least I haven't killed anyone. I haven't slept with anyone else's spouse. I haven't really stolen anything. And what they're trying to do is they're essentially trying to climb their way up the ladder of the law, thinking that they'll gain God's approval that way. But God never intended for his law to be used as a ladder to climb to heaven. Listen, flip back over to Romans chapter 3. We saw this already. Romans chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. Paul is talking about the role of the law, the ministry of the law. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. Because by the works of the law, no flesh, that is no person, will be justified in his sight. That is to be declared righteous by God. For through the law, what? Comes the knowledge of sin. Do you see it there? The reason why the law can't be turned into a ladder to get to heaven is because rather than pointing out everything right about our lives, the law has a way of pointing out everything wrong in our lives, how that we've failed from God's righteousness. And if we may not be actual murderers by our hand, adulterers by our hand, the law points us out as adulterers and murderers and thieves within our heart, right? That was the whole point of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in so many ways. So I hope you see that we have to pray hard for that lost person that they would realize that they can't get to heaven by their own works. You can't. I can't. No one can. We need a righteousness that comes from the outside of ourselves put to our account. One other thing about what Paul says there in those verses. Not only is a lost person zealously wrong, not only are they ignorant of the truth, misguided about righteousness, but they're also unsubmissive toward God. They're rebellious toward God. Again, you see that there. Not knowing about the righteousness of God, they sought to establish a righteousness of their own, and they did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God. The word that's used there for subject is a military word. It's a two-part word. The first part, hupa, has the idea of under, and tasso has the idea of to command, to put under command. That's the idea of the word, to be under command, to be under authority. And so Paul's point here is what he says here is they did not put themselves under the intent of the command of God as to his righteousness. Okay, so this is the idea. In this case, a person who is unsubmissive to the righteousness of God not only doesn't ask God, God, okay, how might I be accepted by you? How might I be approved by you? How might I be regarded as righteous by you? Not only do lost people not ask that question, but in fact they rebel against the answer that God gives as far as how to be considered righteous. And it's through faith, you see. Let me illustrate it this way. If God was to say, okay, there is a plane. There is a plane that will take you to Seattle. And here is the ticket to get on that plane. And that ticket is faith. Not only does the unsubmissive person say, well, there are many ways to get to Seattle instead of on that plane. And I don't need your ticket in order to get on it. This is what a person does when they rebel against God's way of salvation. So, we have to pray. We have to pray against a natural person's inclination to think in these ways. But it's just here, let's just say this, it's just here where we can hear the zealous Jew or another lost person say, now hold on, Paul, how can you say that my efforts to keep the law, my attempts to be a good person, are actually an act of rebellion, unsubmissiveness toward God. How can you say that? Because by my very attempts to keep the law, I'm trying to be submissive to God. I'm trying to do what God says to do. You see? In other words, ought I not to try at all? Ought I not to try to be a good person and keep the law? So the question is, why isn't trying to gain God's acceptance through the law an act of submissiveness, but rather an act of rebellion? You see? Now, before we see the answer that Paul gives us in verse 4, listen to a couple of other texts. Again, look at Romans chapter 3. Why is the typical legalistic mentality of gaining God's approval, why is that an act of rebellion? In Romans chapter 3, look at verse 21 and 22. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, the righteousness that can be put to someone's account to be justified by God, accepted by God, as he said, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe, for there is no distinction. From there, I want you to turn over to Philippians chapter 3, real quick. Philippians 3. You remember, I mean, we could spend a good amount of time thinking about what Paul says here in Philippians chapter 3. He's contrasting his previous life as a Pharisee, his previous life of trying to gain God's acceptance through keeping the works of the law, all of the things that he did and trying to be zealous toward the Lord, and what he came to find out is the only way to be accepted by God. Again, Philippians chapter 3, look at verses 8 and 9. He says this, more than that, I count all things to be loss. That is all of his past efforts in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish so that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, in Christ, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, all of those efforts to try to keep the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith. You see it? It's on the basis of faith. Completely apart from the law. Without any regard to the law. Being accepted by God is through faith in His Son. So the reason why trying to gain God's approval, God's acceptance through your own efforts to keep the law, why that is unsubmissive, why that is rebellious, is because you reject the very way that God has established to be accepted by Him, which is only through faith in Christ. You see it. Here's how Paul puts it in verse 4. He says in verse 4, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. Christ is the end of the law. What does that mean? It means that Paul is saying that Christ fulfilled. Christ met the goal of the law. Everything that the law of God said to do, our Lord Jesus completely fulfilled it perfectly. As perfect, spotless righteousness. Everything that the law said don't do, our Lord Jesus also didn't do. He was completely sinless. Completely sinless. Completely righteous. Do you realize this? I hope you realize this, that no man or woman can keep or has kept the law. No one can keep or has kept the law. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But Christ has. Christ has kept it. And the wonder of the good news is this. The moment a person believes or trusts, has faith in Christ, all that he is and all that he has done on your behalf becomes true of you. You are regarded by God the Father as eternally, perfectly righteous. Not because of you, but because of Him. Right? Sadly, as with the Jews, as long as a person tries to maintain their case, tries to please God, tries to earn salvation through legalism or ritual, if you think to yourself that if you do these 10 things, do these 100 things, do these 200 things, you go through these different rituals of doing different things, that you might be accepted by God, you will never be accepted by God. It's only by that free ticket of faith in Christ. So, the way to honor God and be submissive to Him is to believe, is to trust, is to accept that ticket in order to get on the plane that's going to take you not to Seattle, but take you to heaven. Okay? Just to wrap things up as far as our thoughts on this morning. First of all, are we praying for the lost? Are you praying for the lost? Are there those specific people in your life, maybe a son, a daughter, a next-door neighbor, a work associate, someone that you have been praying for, like Paul, earnestly, agonizing for them in prayer? I hope so. God uses prayer. You think about Monica. Again, Monica praying for Augustine for years. And, you know, when he was converted, this is the most amazing story. I believe he was in Italy at the time. He was in a garden, and he just heard this child kind of singing this song, "Take up and read, take up and read, take up and read." And he picked up the scriptures, which happened to be from Romans at that time, and I think that he turned over to, what verse was it? Here it is, verse 14 of chapter 13. This was the verse that his eyes landed on. It said, "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lust." He was living in sexual sin. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Have faith in Christ. And he was saved in an instant when he read that. His life was never the same. He actually became one of the most respected, most influential church fathers within the early church, defender of the faith that there ever was at that time. Are we praying for the lost? Secondly, does the description of the plight of the lost fit ourselves? It's time to be honest. Maybe there's someone here, you've been zealously wrong, you've been going in the wrong direction, you've been ignorant of the truth. The light of the gospel really hasn't penetrated into your heart. I don't know. Maybe you've been unsubmissive to God, resisting Him, rubbing up against Him rather than, "Lord, how might I be saved? Lord, I want to trust Christ." We all need to come to this passage like a mirror and see ourselves in the Word of God. How do you see yourself within the Word of God today? And lastly, let's just say this. If you're a believer here today, there is only one reason why you're a believer. God. God. God who has turned you away from going in the wrong direction. God who has caused the light of the gospel, the truth, to shine in your soul and revealed His Son in your life. God who opened your eyes to the wonder of receiving that righteousness from Christ, which is outside of yourself, that you stand perfect in the Lord Jesus Christ. God is the only reason why anyone here this morning is a believer. And to Him belongs all the glory. Amen. Yeah. So I hope you're seeing that whereas Romans 9 has all been about the sovereignty of God, now we're getting into the responsibility of man and praying for other people. These things they're a mystery to so many of us, to me as well. How do you reconcile these different truths? Well, they are reconciled, as Charles Spurgeon said, before the throne of God. He knows these things. So let's go ahead and stand and let's just conclude. Lord, as we conclude our time this morning, we just acknowledge to You and to ourselves that this life is fleeting fast. Every birthday, such as Nellie has today, every birthday that we experience is one birthday less from our total. Lord God, we are moving one way or another to meeting You face to face, either as our executioner or as our Savior. Lord, we pray that these incredible truths would just set our hearts on fire. And that we really would respond to these things by first of all, examining ourselves to see if we are participating in this great salvation of free righteousness put to our account. And if so, whether we are praying for others, yearning for others. Lord, during this short period of time which we have left in our lives, we pray that we would just be living completely and fully for you. Help us to do that, we pray. Save the lost that are around us. Use us, Lord God, toward that end. Thank you for your good word this morning. May you be honored and glorified in all of it, we pray. Through Jesus our Savior. Amen. Amen. Greet someone, don't rush off.